guys. Okay, so we are reading The Wizard of Oz by L. Frank Baum with pictures by W.W. Denslow. And we were in the middle of, I believe, let's see, it was chapter number 20. The dainty China country, right? So they found a white wall, they climbed over it after they built a ladder, and onward they went to explore, and they were finding all sorts of people made out of China, right? And they found a princess and a clown that had obviously been broken a few times. And so we were here, and the clown was saying silly things, right? And the princess was like, oh, you gotta be careful. So we are on page 216 now, right? So the clown put his hands in his pockets, and after puffing out his cheeks and nodding his head at them saucily, he said, my lady fair, why do you stare at poor old Mr. Joker? You're quite as stiff and prim as if you'd eaten up a poker. Be quiet, sir, said the princess. Can't you see these are strangers and should be treated with respect? Well, that's respect, I expect, declared the clown, and immediately stood on his head, because he's a clown. Don't mind Mr. Joker, said the princess to Dorothy. He's considerably cracked in his head, and that makes him foolish. Cracked in his head is another way of saying, and it's also funny because he's a China sculpture and he's cracked. Oh, I don't mind him a bit, said Dorothy. But you are so beautiful, she continued, that I am sure I could love you dearly. Won't you let me carry you back to Kansas and stand you on Aunt Em's mantel shelf? I could carry you in my basket. That would make me very unhappy, answered the China princess. You see, here in our own country, we live contentedly and can talk and move about as we please. But whenever any of us are taken away, our joints at once stiffen and we can only stand straight and look pretty. Of course, that is all that is expected of us when we are on mantel shelves and cabinets and drawing room tables, but our lives are much pleasanter here in our own country. I would not make you unhappy for all the world, exclaimed Dorothy. So I'll just say goodbye. Goodbye, replied the princess. They walked carefully through China country, through the China country. The little animals and all the people scampered out of their way, fearing the strangers would break them. And after an hour or so, the travelers reached the other side of the country and came to another China wall. It was not as high as the first, however, and by standing upon the lion's back, they all managed to scramble to the top. Then the lion gathered his legs under him and jumped on the wall. But as soon as he jumped, he upset a China church with his tail and smashed it all to pieces. That was too bad, said Dorothy. But really, I think we were lucky in not doing these little people more harm than breaking a cow's leg and a church. They are all so brittle. They are indeed, said the Scarecrow, and I am thankful I am made of straw and cannot be easily damaged. There are worse things in the world than being a Scarecrow. So there's the clown standing on his head. The cracked clown. All right, so now we are on chapter, I believe, so we are on chapter number 21, which starts on page 218. Here we go, we're gonna read it. It's not very long. After climbing down from the China wall, the travelers found themselves in a disagreeable country, full of bogs and marshes covered with tall, rank grass. It was difficult to walk far without falling into muddy holes, for the grass was so thick that it hid them from sight. However, by carefully picking their way, they got safely along until they reached solid ground. But here, the country seemed wilder than ever, and after a long and tiresome walk through the underbrush, they entered another forest where the trees were bigger and older than any they had ever seen. This forest is perfectly delightful, declared the lion, looking around him with joy. Never have I seen a more beautiful place. It seems gloomy, said the Scarecrow. Not a bit of it, answered the lion. I should like to live here all my life. See how the dried leaves are under your feet and how rich and green the moss is that clings to these old trees. Surely no wild beast could wish a pleasanter home.
Perhaps there are wild beasts in the forest now, said Dorothy.
I suppose there are, returned the lion, but I do not see any of them about. They walked through the forest until it became too dark to go any further. Dorothy and Toto and the lion lay down to sleep while the woodman and scarecrow kept watch over them as usual. When morning came, they started again. Before they had gone far, they heard a low rumble,
as of the growling of many wild animals.
Toto whimpered a little, but none of the others was frightened, and they kept along the well-trodden path until they came to an opening in the wood, in which were gathered hundreds of beasts of every variety. There were tigers and elephants and bears and wolves and foxes and all the others in the natural history, and for a moment, Dorothy was afraid. But the lion explained that the animals were holding a meeting, and he judged by their snarling and growling that they were in great trouble. As he spoke, several of the beasts caught sight of him, and at once the great assemblage hushed as if by magic. The biggest of the tigers came up to the lion and bowed, saying, "Welcome, O King of Beasts! You have come in good time to fight our enemy and bring peace to all the animals of the forest once more."
"What is your trouble?" asked the lion quietly.
"We are all threatened," answered the tiger, "by a fierce enemy which has come lately into this forest. It is a most tremendous monster, like a great spider, with a body as big as an elephant and legs as long as a tree trunk. It has eight of these long legs, and as the monster crawls through the forest, he seizes an animal with a leg and drags it to his mouth, where he eats it. As a spider does a fly, not one of us is safe while this fierce creature is alive, and we have called a meeting to decide how to take care of ourselves when you came among us."
"Are there any other lions in this forest?"
he asked. "No, there were some, but the monster has eaten them all, and besides, there were none of them nearly so large and brave as you."
"If I put an end to your enemy, will you bow down to me and obey me as king of the forest?" inquired the lion.
"We would do that gladly," returned the tiger, and all the other beasts roared with a mighty roar, "We will!"
"Where is this great spider of yours now?" asked the lion.
"Yonder, among the oak trees," said the tiger, pointing with his forefoot.
"Take good care of these friends of mine," said the lion, "and I will go at once to fight the monster."
He bade his comrades goodbye and marched proudly away to do battle with the enemy. The great spider was lying asleep when the lion found him, and it looked so ugly that its foe turned up its nose in disgust. Its legs were quite as long as the tiger had said, and its body covered with coarse black hair. It had a great mouth with a row of sharp teeth, a foot long.
This is like from my palm to my elbow, like a foot long.
Woohoo! But its head was joined to the pudgy body by a neck as slender as a wasp's waist. This gave the lion a hint of the best way to attack the creature, and as he knew it was easier to fight it asleep than awake, he gave a great spring and landed directly upon the monster's back. Then, with one blow of his heavy paw, all armed with sharp claws, he knocked the spider's head from its body. Jumping down, he watched it until the long legs stopped wiggling, when he knew it was quite dead. The lion went back to the opening where the beasts of the forest were waiting for him, and said proudly,
"You need fear your enemy no longer."
Then the beasts bowed down to the lion as their king, and he promised to come back and rule over them as soon as Dorothy was safely on her way back to Kansas. So this is the beginning of the chapter. And this is the end of the chapter. All right, so we'll pick up next time with, I believe, chapter number 21, which I believe is called The Lion, The Country of the Quadlings. So remember, the Quadlings are in the south of Oz, right? All right, guys. Catch you later. Bye for now.